Okay, good afternoon. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm asking, I am starting this special session. And really, somehow, you will see that this speciality of this session emerged quite naturally. So just it appeared that the speakers of this session, they know Valentin Ivanovich, they are his students or collaborators, old friends. And so just somehow this idea emerged. And this is not real celebration. So just we are going to have a real celebration after the just virus and all these precautions will pass, just online it's not real somehow. But this session, as you will see from the talks, it's very deeply related to work of Valentin Ivanovich, and also various subjects of his activity. And somehow, maybe because of this speciality of this session, somehow I am also a speaker here. And so I'm starting by you will see that the just topics of the talks of this session will be predominantly more theoretical. And anomalous transport, it's related to anomaly. And of course, anomaly, as there is a chirality in the current, it's necessarily related to spin. However, here in my just talk, I put spin at the first place because I will speak mostly about various manifestation of spin, of real spin effects, and how anomaly comes there. And so basically this is the point, just I'm going to speak about anomaly and observable spin effects. And in particular, comparing various manifestations of anomaly. And one is the comparison of anomalous gluon contributions to hadronic spin and chiral vortical effect, which is just maybe better to call axial vertical effect. When actually here there is a subject which we are discussing with Valentin Ivanovich for a while. Just appearance, the first suggestion I'm going to share with you, how so-called Zilch current are related to gluon polarization in nucleon. And second issue, this is how baryon polarization in heavy ion collisions is related to dissipation in the course of quantum vortices. And as you see, just it's everything is essentially based on the work of Valentin Ivanovich. And what is the observable related to spin, and which is probably currently mostly discussed in relation to heavy ion collision, but typically it's not considered very related to anomaly. So I will try to somehow to support the point of view that it is related. And this is the polarization emerging in heavy ion collision. And well, it happens that probably in heavy ion collision, there is the highest ever possible angular velocity. It's like if you calculate, perform the order of back on the envelope estimation, like maybe 25 orders of magnitude higher than Earth's rotation frequency. Well, and also it emerges differential rotation, which is important vorticity. So it can lead to various periodic effect, which is magnetic. Well, because it's like magnetic field Well, magnetic field is also very high, but not the highest. The highest, as we learned yesterday, is on the it existed in the early universe. And but also there is a very high acceleration, and it appears that by coincidence there is a almost the same ratio with the Earth acceleration. And the question: how this rotation can be converted to spin polarization? And when we just maybe 10 years from now, we just in Dubna looked for a possible program of the accelerator, which is under construction, which is also just discussed here in this conference. We thought about induced axial current. And here as a coupling emerges the square of chemical potential. So one should naturally expect that chemical potential is decreasing at small energy, that polarization should also, chemical potential is decreasing with energy, so polarization should be peaked at small energies. And this is what we wrote here, that we, of course, were thinking mostly just about Nika. And also we mentioned the beam energies gamma trick, and what happened, and indeed that of course not because we suggested that, but a trick, it was really found and published in Nature actually 7 years after this publication. And this I taken just some extraction from this paper, and here one can see, so this is how this emerges. There is some coupling, where new coupling, where velocity appears as a gauge field, and this is taken from then recent paper of Son and Surovka. But here it is written that just explicitly mentioned that we learned from that from the seminar talk. We have just a joint seminar with ITEP then over Valentin Ivanovich, who came, and somehow we used that immediately. And indeed.
Sorry to interrupt. Maybe it's better to make a full screen mode.
Let me try.
Sorry.
Yes, let me try, but
F5?
But first I probably need to...
Never mind.
Yes.
Small letters cannot be seen, probably, I'm not sure.
I see. This is because, this is exactly,
So well, I'm not sure. It's like.
Yeah. Well, it's.
Пока слайдов.
Yes, and what is here and okay, okay, like Sorry. This. Yes, is it better?
Yeah. It's much better. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. So hopefully I can also just. Okay, it works. Well, so here it's written. So what is here? That for velocity is also a gauge field, and it's appeared in the paper of Valentin Ivanovich, Andrei Sadofiev and Shevchenko. And here this is really appears as a gauge field. So it comes from the definition of chemical potential written in Lorentz invariant way. Then anomaly plays a special role because anomaly is, and this is the specifics, another specifics of anomalous transport, because anomaly is non-renormalizable. Although there is really no anomaly on anomaly induced current. But what is really essential and what was instructive, but somehow it recalls the so-called anomalous gluon contribution to nucleon spin, which appeared just already many years from now. And just at that time, it was just appeared already after just a while. Somehow this appears that here the instead of gluon field, there is a collective field, which is for velocity. Now, just there is appears to be some another relation to between hadrons and heavy ions, and this is happens that so-called Zilch current, whose name is somehow self-explanatory in the sense that they are considered to be a sort of nonsense. And but they noticed that a while, so just this is similar to gluon polarization. Now preparing this talk, I finally managed to test it more explicitly. Yes, indeed, it happens that they coincide. They coincide. The Zilch current coincide. The operator constructed from the corresponding of this current just coincide with gluon polarization, and just explicitly, this is a Zilch current in the form just suggested by Kibble, and this is operator leading twist operator which constructed from gluon field, and if you take here more this a matrix element. If you take some particular n equal to 3 containing only one derivative, and if you take longitudinal polarization, and this current is symmetric, and longitudinal polarization also provides because the polarization is proportional to momentum, so and it can be explicitly extracted by contracted to light cone vectors, and then but also minus sign here appears to be quite essential because it corresponds to differentiation with respect to relative coordinate, and this relative coordinate appears just because of forward matrix element. Now there is also covariant derivative which may be somehow here in the operator product expansion axial gauge is natural, but maybe also can be non-abelian generalization of Zilch, and finally matrix element of Zilch contracted with the Z is proportional to this moment over the gluon polarization. One can ask, is it such a relation to in principle observable quantity somehow still remain needs to be Zilch. And now why it is interesting, why we considered it, because in somehow if you consider different operators with derivative, it's possible to have a sort of non-local generalization of anomaly. So consider non-local current, this is gauge invariant, and to consider its divergence. There are terms which appears due to these terms, and in fact they are non-anomalous, they emerge on the level of equation of motions. But there is some generalization of anomaly. It's possible to introduce non-local topological current, and to have actually a tower of just anomalous operators. And here it's possible to explicitly extract the anomaly like it is done for local case. And here for non-local operators, the non-local operators, they are somehow gauge invariant and contains derivative. If you take first moment, it's either gauge invariant, either gauge invariant by its integral. So it's non-local in that sense. Or it is it's topological current, it's problem of gauge invariance and so on. And why it is interesting? Because in statistical approach, well, this will be in the talk of Valentin Ivanovich, just I guess there are just polynomial in statistical counterpart of just field theory. There are just the, this this Sommerfeld integrals and various Sommerfeld integrals, so it can be various sort of similar to be to anomalies. Here there is very simple function and very simple coefficient, not looking like that in Sommerfeld integrals. But maybe here it's on light cone. Maybe going to light off light cone, it's possible to get like that. Another interesting situation. Actually, let me first mention this. Another situation. I should take care of time myself. I will try. But another interesting situation, which somehow related to work of Valentin Ivanovich, and somehow it's related to our last speaker today, Arkady Weinstein, is related to this conserved current appearing from anomaly, even local current, and angular momentum conservation. And angular momentum conservation can be written, angular momentum can be written in terms of symmetric operator. Belinfante tensor, also it is coincide with Hilbert tensor, describing the coupling to gravity. And actually another contribution of Valentin Ivanovich, which I learned basically from Arkady Weinstein, is the derivation of equivalence principle from conservation laws. And this actually involves such a symmetric operator. So is there any relation of this axial current enters to spin in the totally provides totally antisymmetric contribution? What happens that in order to combine these terms, to combine various representation, you need some smoothness of boundary terms. And this smoothness translated to momentum space provides some explicit constraint for matrix element of operators. And what is interesting, it's for singlet axial current, which corresponds to the total quark spin, it's exclude the zero mass poles. And this is well known because it's your famous UA1 problem. So it appears that UA1 somehow QCD is arranged in such a way in order to allow this non-local transformation. Now let me just come to how to explore this axial current related to polarization. And in fact, one can use the axial charge. And matrix element of axial charge can be calculated on the level of quarks. But assuming a sort of duality, quark hadron duality, which may be considered because it's anomaly, a kind of Hooft principle, this may be somehow calculated on hadronic level. And due to this, you get you may calculate the anomaly, just calculating the axial charge and dividing by number of particle. What is important, performing boost, because when particles are moving, then it's get zero component and the sign depends on its direction. And in this way, actually the polarization at the energies of Nika was predicted several years before the data of Rick on the level of some percent or so. Now, what is interesting that another way to look to that is so-called chiral separation effect. And the point is that a zero component corresponds to axial charge. But special charge in chiral separation effect is proportional to magnetic field. Oh, but also this is another side of axial vortical effect to vorticity. What is important to say that all this term, by considering the full expression for axial current containing electromagnetic and hydrodynamic pieces, appears in the paper of Valentin Ivanovich with Andrei Sadovyev, who will give next talk, also with Avdoshkin and Kirillin. And so how to match to this to expression, because zero component somehow zero component depends on the direction of how particle is moving. And somehow the space component is proportional to vorticity. Now it's the outcome, the only possibility to combine these two is somehow that vorticity, that velocity, and finally scalar product of velocity to vorticity, which is hydrodynamic helicity, need to also to change sign. And this is what was observed in model, but maybe it's indeed just the requires by invariance. And final point, this which I would like to discuss, and this corresponds to yet another property of single spin asymmetries, And this is just because of the polarization correspond to single spin asymmetry. And single spin asymmetry is that there is a polarization in scattering, and it's just appears already in quantum quantum mechanics. And but what is required? It's required that it's proportional to normal to the some plane. It contains the helicity, the interference of amplitude. One of the amplitude must be dependent spin, so it's a sort of spin orbital coupling, and also a phase. And what is then? This is common, so that that it's just involve the parity conservation, spin orbital, and the necessity for absorptive phase. And what is the counterpart of for heavy ions? And the suggestion which we explored, this should be dissipation. Because, well, there are phases where even named absorptive, it's appearance of other particles, so it must be dissipation. It was discussed another. For hadrons, it's quite different things. And finally, just we considered it with several years from now. We considered it in the another just using exploring another just finding of Valentin Ivanovich with his students by with and this is superfluidity in pionic fluid. And although generally for on scalar particles it's not possible to construct the axial current, but if there are vortices, and vortices means impossibility to just interchange the order of derivatives, it can be such current. And what happens, and vortices are quantines, the circulations is constant, and if you're approaching the center of vortice, of course, the velocity must increase, but it never can increase. It can be higher than speed of light. And the suggestion of Valentin Ivanovich was let it be the core. And in the core, there is a hard degrees of freedom. And this is baryon degrees of freedom appears a radiative correction. And here, this is the polarization. And in transition of light to heavy degrees of freedom, this is exactly to dissipation. So just my talk here. Just I would just say that for me the main point here is the points which will be expressed in the talks, and for me it's very interesting problem. There are first observability, and this is just how anomalous transport is coming to physics, and second there are various interconnections, and this talk will be expressed here. And we are starting
okay, thank you, I guess.
The next speaker is Andrei Kotov. please Andrei. Well, I think because we have a discussion and somehow my talk is introductory, maybe just if there are just some.
It's up to you. It's up to you. I mean, move all the questions for the discussion session.
But if there are some urgent question, I believe we still have some time. So just I can try to answer them from the beginning, and if not, we move to the discussion. Just at the moment, I. So just at the moment, I don't see, right? And urgent questions.